We now move on to agenda item three, animal welfare, health and welfare. Again, apologies for those witnesses waiting to join us. We've had an IT glitch here, as you'll be aware. We've also taken the decision not to hear from the second panel today to give us enough time to ask the questions we have for our first panel. And in the first panel of stakeholders, we have Kirsty Jenkins, Policy Officer from OneKind, Dr. Romain Pizzi, the President of the Scottish Branch of the British Veterinary Association, Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish Society for Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, and Dr. Simon Turner, the Senior Researcher of Animal and Veterinary Science from Scotland's Rural Colleges. We are not going to have introductions from you this morning, given time constraints. So we'll move straight on into questions. And I'd like to open with some questions on the impact of EU exit in relation to animal welfare. So going around the panel, can you identify any gaps in the regulations of animal health and welfare following EU exit, either operationally with regards to disease surveillance or veterinary or biosecurity capacity within the UK? We're well aware that we have labour shortages and across sectors. So possibly we could start with Romain to give us a heads up on what's happening with the veterinary workforce at the moment and address other issues when you come to them. Thank you.
So thank you for the invitation to give evidence. I think there are a couple of key points, and some of them are obviously covered in BVA's manifesto and relate to this. But one of our concerns obviously goes about the recent trade agreement with Australia. Although that there is this 15-year phasing out of tariffs from the British Veterinary Association, we're obviously concerned that the announcement paves the way for this tariff-free and quota-free imports, and then we are going to be outsourcing any animal welfare problems and disadvantaging farmers and the community in Scotland when they do good efforts to improve animal health and welfare to places where there may be lower standards. And there's we're obviously concerned on that. So we're calling on governments centrally, obviously, to spell out how it's going to safeguard welfare. And obviously, we want a formal trade and agricultural commission with a new that is statutory, with veterinary involvement to ensure that. So we are aware of workplace problems, obviously, with veterinary capacity at the moment. And we think that although in Scotland we've been coping with, obviously, the export health certification, we've already estimated from the British Veterinary Association's perspective that between January and August of this year, there's been an extra 204 years' worth of certified time spent on the export health certification. Now, the actual veterinary demands haven't materialized largely yet because things have been delayed with everything being fully operational. So with provisions for the scheme for the temporary agri-food movements to Northern Ireland, when that gets phased out, we will need obviously certification for many more goods that are going to move from Scotland to Northern Ireland. And that was originally due to happen in the 1st of October. So the problem is that the amount of export health certification across the UK is estimated, from DEFRA to be between 70 and 150,000 extra to meet that Northern Ireland demand, which is the equivalent of another 70 full-time official veterinarians, which is something that is going to be very, very difficult to meet. So we also know that the EU animal health law means that this is also going to be updated. And so a particular problem for Scotland is that certificates relating to fish and shellfish will require an official veterinarian signature. Now, in the past, that's been the fish health inspectors that have done that. And so the British Veterinary Association has been in discussions with the Fish Veterinary Society, with the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons, as well as DEFRA, to try and see how we can actually make this work. So now it's been delayed, but the problem has not been resolved yet. So that is obviously a significant concern. But the other concern that we have from the British Veterinary Association is that we do need import checks for sanitary controls. And so the problem is that currently with we're not really assured that that's actually been met. Because the border checks are going to be phased in, there's been no consultation with the veterinary profession at large, and no assurances by the government that relevant biosecurity risks associated with us delaying implementing this really have been assessed properly or managed. So we are fortunate in Scotland with relatively good biosecurity. We're a TB-free country, for example, compared to England. But obviously this relies on good surveillance, and the first part of surveillance is obviously import scanning. So although we have problems with capacity, just delaying these import checks is problematic. We put Scottish agriculture at risk and animal health and welfare, and it's much simpler to prevent problems than address them afterwards, as the foot and mouth pandemic showed everyone. So that was particularly worrying. And we obviously, another complication is that we no longer have direct access to the European surveillance network. So we don't have as good information on what risks are posed from the imports, and we're not checking what's actually coming in. So we're very fortunate. We have a super chief veterinary officer in Scotland who's very proactive, and she's got really good personal relationships. But that's not an ideal way for us to be relying for information on what is happening with diseases and surveillance in Europe, is a personal relationship of the chief veterinary officer. So that is a major concern for us. So I guess to try and make this whole situation more functional, what British Veterinary Association is really trying to push for is, there's a limit to obviously what everyone can do, is to try and improve things, is obviously that the current system, there's a lot of really archaic bureaucracy that we need to try and overhaul to reduce the time costs and the error and everything associated with that. And also to really review the requirements for inspection and certification and get those as slick and as fit for purpose as needed. And then I think we do need to negotiate a form of mutual veterinary agreement with the EU, which will help to ease the problems with moving and trading food and feed between Great Britain as a whole and the EU and Northern Ireland in both directions, as these different import controls obviously will take effect. So, you know, that is a big problem for us. And moving away from agriculture, we have similar problems with companion animals. So pet travel requirements are also, you know, impacted by the workforce at the moment. So the pet passport scheme used to be relatively easy to fill in. Now we have a 9-12 page long document, the animal health certificate, which is much more complex, problematic. It's much easier for veterinarians to get it wrong. I find it's really quite difficult to work through. It can take 45 minutes to an hour for a vet to do this. So obviously there's a big knock-on cost for owners. There's the risk that you go through all of this and you make an error, which is obviously a major concern. The vets are much more cautious about agreeing to do these. So just as the need for increased capacity across all these years is expanding, sort of we have a reticence amongst many members of the profession to actually engage and actually pull back from it. So there is a limit, obviously. You know, the paperwork is set by the EU and it can't be changed by government. But what the British Veterinary Association is asking is really for some help in, let's say, completing the certification for the companion animals, and simple things like a simple checklist to make it a bit more error-free. Because there's no point going through all this expense and time when we have limited capacity. There's lots of pressure and unhappiness from the animal owners, and then we make errors, and animal welfare obviously, you know, falls in from that. So I think that there's, I know we are short of time because there are other aspects, but I think I'd probably it's a good time to ask the other participants, and if there's anything specific you'd like me to give further information on, then obviously I'd be happy to address that.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Dr. Simon Turner to address that, and then I'm going to go to supplementaries from Alistair Allen and Rachel Hamilton.
Okay, thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to give evidence also. I would, with regard to European exit, I would agree that the programme of government seems to be appropriate and well aligned with moves within the European Union with regard to ending cage confinement for pheasants, layers and pigs. Just to follow from Romain's points, I think we would also share concerns with regard to external competition from imported animal products produced to lower standards. We do need to ensure we avoid a perfect storm situation whereby we almost export welfare problems and in such a manner that those welfare problems potentially are larger and less transparent than they are with animals produced in this country. And at the same time, we reduce the profitability of Scottish farmers to safeguard animal welfare. For example, if farmers have insufficient capital to employ labour, then we know that reduced labour has a major impact on animal welfare in various sectors, in the sheep sector, for example, in particular. And this is clearly likely to be one of the key areas where farmers will seek to reduce costs, and we've seen that already in recent years and decades. So I think we need to ensure that we prevent this kind of perfect storm situation from occurring. I would also just say, with regard to the aligning and keeping pace with the European legislation, that I think we also need to keep an eye also towards aligning with compliance. The European Court of Auditors has raised concerns within the European Union with regard to the lack of harmony and implementation of legislation within European member states and general lack of compliance. And if they get on board with that, then we also need to keep an eye to making sure that we are also complying, I guess. Okay.
Thank you. Just on that, can I have your views on where Scotland should and shouldn't seek alignment with the EU? Mike, would you like to come in on that?
From the Scottish SPCA point of view, as you know, high animal welfare does cost far, and we've got some of the best standards in the world. And what we would like to see is any
Mike, I'm sorry, I'm going to stop you there. I'm sorry, Mike. We can't hear you at the moment. We'll try Kirsty, and hopefully we can get your connection stabilised a bit. Kirsty, have you got any comments?
Thank you. Yes, thank you, convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I think Dr. Turner made some good points about where we plan to stay aligned with the EU. We need to also be aware of potential problems with compliance and so on. I think that the UK and Scotland are making some positive moves away from what the EU currently has in terms of the potential ban on live exports, for example. But there are other areas where I think the EU could possibly have some things we would want to stay aligned with. One example would be the sustainable aquaculture guidelines, which the EU has recently published. They have a chapter specifically on animal welfare, which is something that we would really welcome looking at our salmon farming in Scotland, for example. So that's just one example.
Okay, thanks. I'm now going to bring in Alistair for some supplementaries.
Thank you, convener. Dr. Turner, you mentioned the perfect storm that might arise from from the situation following Brexit. Obviously, one of those issues, and you touched on it, I think, is trade deals. Can you give us more of your view on what trade deals might imply in terms of the kind of meat that might be coming into the country in terms of animal welfare standards, and also whether it's even more of a perfect storm in your view if the UK Internal Market Act has an impact on Scotland's discretion to alter some of these things for on its own hand?
I wouldn't say I'm qualified to comment specifically on trade deals and what the implications of those are. With regard to the harmonisation or lack of harmonisation within the UK, I think we have to recognise that Scotland particularly has a unique welfare, partly as a result of our predominance of pasture-based ruminant systems, and that is perceived. And we do need to protect that. I think there is a risk from the internal market bill of a race to the bottom of us ending up with the same legislation as the least ambitious of the four nations. And I think we do need to protect that for the benefit of Scotland's marketing position externally. I think I'll leave it at that.
Thank you for that. It's interesting to hear how you describe some of the problems that potentially could arise if we're not careful out of the internal market bill there in terms of animal welfare. In terms, you mentioned ambition around animal welfare. Can I also ask in that case what your ambitions might be, and this might apply to others on the panel as well, what your ambitions might be for animal welfare if we do have a keeping pace power in the future, or keeping pace and tension in the future when it comes to European legislation. Aquaculture has been mentioned, but what might other ambitions in animal welfare be?
It would be quite easy to get specific about this, but I mean, I think as a general principle, we need to question whether we want to keep pace or whether we want to think in certain ways about staying ahead of the European Union. I think there's possibly some arguments to be made that the UK and Scotland in particular has been ahead of our European competitors for a number of years in some sectors, and that has, the difference has diminished in recent years, and we might want to think about whether we need to stay ahead. I think, I mean, specifically with regard to areas like cage-free systems, we need to make sure that the timeline is not out of sync with the European Union. There are some quite ambitious targets being spoken about for removal of animals from cage systems, and we need to ensure that we follow that. But we could also be, I could speak about many different research priorities that that we ought to be addressing, things like finding alternatives to carbon dioxide stunning of pigs, for example. We've been looking at the potential for low atmospheric pressure stunning of pigs, and the research evidence from Scotland Rural College and the University of Edinburgh in Glasgow suggests that it's not a refinement for animal welfare, and we should possibly be thinking of what the alternatives are there to stay ahead and possibly stay ahead of other competitors on that.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Rachel.
Could I ask Dr. Pizzi, I hope I haven't pronounced your name wrong, but it was just a point you made in your answer to the first question. I'm right in saying, aren't I, that Scotland would be in its own legislative rights to introduce its own food safety checks on imports, because food safety is a devolved area. Is that something that you would support?
So I think, I mean, we know that in the SNP manifesto, there is a commitment towards moving towards a Scottish veterinary service, and we see advantages and potential risks to it. I mean, there are some big advantages, as Simon and others have said. We've been quite lucky in Scotland in that we've positioned ourselves with sort of high welfare, high value, sort of premium products with agriculture, and then we tend to not want to dilute that with sort of a dilution of low welfare, low quality products coming in from either elsewhere, sometimes in the UK, or from external to the UK, and that's been problematic. I think the opportunities for doing things uniquely from a Scottish perspective is that our situation is quite different to many other parts of the UK, in that we've got about 50% of all the trout farming, we've got pretty much all the salmon farming, and that's a huge importance economically and agriculturally in Scotland, and that's often missed when there's a UK-wide perspective. So, you know, when we move to a more Scottish-centric system and the Scottish Veterinary Service, then there is an opportunity to budget and plan and take that more into perspective. And, you know, for example, the British Veterinary Association is very keen on us having legislative protections for farmed fish and slaughter. Now, that's of particular importance in Scotland because of the agriculture segment. So, and that tends to get diluted across in the UK. So, you know, and at the moment, we still rely on that being industry sort of run, and we know these changes are coming from EU imports. The other risks, I mean, is that pretty much the same situation as happens with Europe, is that diseases do not respect borders, as we've learned from COVID, as we learned from other diseases. So what we would be very cautious of is with a new Scottish Veterinary Service is that we become very insular, because the border may very well exist between England and Scotland for all of us for legislation, but it doesn't, viruses don't care less about that. So, you know, there need to be very good liaison with the Scottish Veterinary Service as it collaborates and develops with the rest of the UK, and trying to get better information, obviously, from Europe to make this all work. So data sharing, collaboration, communication will be really, really important, because the UK as a whole is one epidemiological unit. That's how we manage COVID. That's how we manage diseases, because of the ease of movement. And so that is one obviously concern and risk to having it you know, very separated. So I think it's a balance, and I think it can be achieved. There's great potential there for us to maintain good animal welfare and health, but we would need to see, you know, good continued investment in disease surveillance. So at the moment, you know, Dr. Turner's the expert on this, we're quite different to England. We've got animal and plant health, which will do both, you know, will do everything in England, whereas in Scotland, that's quite different. The Scottish, you know, SRUC manages the surveillance part, and that's changed recently to sort of a hub and spoke system. And so moving forward, we think, obviously, with the Scottish centric and veterinary service, we really need to assess how well has that actually worked for stakeholders, and get a variety of opinions and get some evidence, and then use that as a basis of moving forward and deciding what is the best way to make this fit for Scotland, but not making ourselves so insular that we actually put ourselves to risk.
I'm going to bring in Jim on, with a brief supplementary on your contribution there, Jim.
Yeah. Can I just ask, are we going to get time to go to the farm animal section? Because it's possibly better that we get it in that rather than try to put it out into the broader picture.
Yeah, absolutely. If you want to ask your questions on farm animals right now, that's fine.
Okay, I'll specifically look at the farm animal side of things, which is coming further down. First of all, Mr. Peasy, I apologise if I mispronounced your name. You talked right at the start of your answer about the food regulations and standards, that we could be offshoring them. So would you agree that the Parish Amendment that went through the UK Parliament was a missed opportunity? But I want to focus specifically on three main things: BVD, TB and yonies. Mr. Allen talked about ambition for the industry and for what we actually want to achieve. Now, we're well on the way to eradicating BVD, if we haven't already done it. Our TB status is far greater in Scotland than what it is down in England. And we have a plan now to get rid of yonies altogether. And I know that's a long-term plan. It's not going to be easy to do. Do we not need a very Scottish-centric system in place to allow us to continue with the standards that we currently have and to allow us to eradicate yonies?
That's a good question. And I mean, Simon is probably the expert to answer on the specifics. I do think there is definite opportunity for the Scottish Veterinary Service. And we know, you know, there was the original report by Charles Milne that's been updated, and we look forward to seeing and feeding back into that. And it will be finding a structure that actually works. And obviously, what is paramount to this is that there is adequate funding for surveillance, because we can have a Scottish-centric system, but if we're not careful with the budgeting, then that is not going to be fit for purpose. So I think that the budgeting to maintain good surveillance becomes crucial, and the communication, because there is going to be risk, coming from outside Scotland, communication and maintaining this as a bigger epidemiological unit is still essential. Although we are TB-free officially in Scotland, there is still considerable risk there. So I'm not the farm animal disease expert. I think Simon is the person to speak to the specifics more than that. But I think we do see an opportunity. We see an opportunity also in Scotland with the agricultural consultation, you know, that's just gone out. For many things, we're a little bit disappointed in that agricultural consultation that is very little mention of animal health or welfare, surprisingly, and there's not a single mention of veterinary intervention, which seems a little bit unbelievable. And from obviously replacing the common agricultural policy, we know Scotland is aligning itself very much with the EU, but we do see an opportunity to reward good animal health and welfare so that there's, you know, public funding for public goods in a way that possibly wasn't possible with a common agricultural policy. So there's a lot of potential there, and it's finding the balance that we know will be the challenge. I think Simon can probably speak to the specifics far better than I can.
I'm going to bring you in, Simon, but can you also maybe explore the suggestion that we have something like 20% mortality within the livestock industry in Scotland that could be prevented through vaccinations and whatever. What's your opinion on a national vaccination scheme to address some of the issues that Jim's already brought up?
I'm afraid I don't actually have a veterinary background. Rumin does me, he flatters me. I'd have to direct you to some of my colleagues with an SYUC, I'm afraid.
Okay. Ed, Romain, do you have any thoughts about a national vaccination scheme, which if we could reduce mortality, it would have quite a considerable impact on the carbon footprint of livestock production in Scotland as well?
I can't speak to the specifics, unfortunately, although I'm the Scottish branch representative for BVA. My background, unfortunately, is quite different. So it is something, though, that we can certainly come back to you in writing and hopefully save you some time now and give you a more specific answer. So I'll ensure that happens.
Yeah, that would be useful. Ariane?
So with the high probability that the new trade deals will allow the importation of animal food products which do not meet the UK's own animal welfare standards, I'd like to hear your thoughts, and I'm going to direct this to Kirsty, and I think if we've got Mike back. I would like to hear your thoughts on how this potential situation could be managed and how Scottish residents could be encouraged to value meat and other animal food products which meet high welfare standards. So, Kirsty.
Thank you, Ariane. It's a good point that's already been touched on. I think trade negotiations are posing a huge threat to our animal welfare standards, as Simon also already mentioned. And I think that the Internal Market Act exacerbates that risk for Scotland, because obviously the Scottish Government does not have any control over the trade negotiations. And the Internal Market Act means that we would be required to allow those products into Scotland. So it is tricky, because we are limited in the power that we have in Scotland. To go to your point about how individual people could be encouraged to make change, I think that the introduction of animal welfare labelling would be a really beneficial thing in general, but also with this risk of products coming in from other countries that possibly don't meet our welfare standards. So we would support method of production plus labelling. So that basically means labelling that would describe the method of production. So we currently have such a thing for eggs. So all eggs are labelled with whether they're organic, free range, barn, etc. We should extend that to meat and dairy as well. But the plus part would mean that there would also be additional information. So that could be in the form of, for example, I think the Netherlands has 3 stars, 1, 2, or 3 stars. France has a system which is like an A to E And these are based on a variety of animal welfare measures. But I think that kind of labelling, it's there's currently the UK government has an open consultation on it. And I would we would strongly welcome the introduction of such labelling because that allows consumers to choose higher welfare products.
Thank you. And I don't think we've got have we got Mike? No.
It's Mike back and audio only.
Mike, do you want to come in on that question?
Yeah, I mean, some excellent points have already been made. And one thing that the Scottish SPCA is pretty adamant about is we've got some of the best farmers in the world, and high animal welfare costs farmers a lot of money. So we're concerned about products coming in from countries that have got lower standards of animal welfare or veterinary provisions. And it would be good to see in the Programme for Government the sustainable Scottish labels mentioned, that should have a high emphasis on animal welfare and not just environmental and economic issues, but social and acceptability, including good animal welfare. So we are here to support Scottish farmers and not to put them at any disadvantage.
Thank you.
And Dr. Main, Beatsy.
Yes, so just to respond, I completely agree from the British Veterinary Association's perspective with Kirsty and Mike in that we are leading in many ways above the rest of the UK. I mean, Scotland is the only part that we don't have any animals being, having non-stun slaughter. But then we disadvantage our farmers and our producers in this high welfare situation in that we can still get non-stun products ending up on Scotland supermarket shelves, but there's no way of differentiating whether it comes from England or whether it comes from overseas. And so we're actually harming our farmers and our producers and systems that are, investing in better welfare. So we really do, as the BVA, want to call for clear labelling of meat and meat products for animals that have not been stunned before slaughter, so that consumers can make that choice. So, Quality Meat Scotland and the other farm assurance schemes really are important in empowering shoppers to make sustained and ethically informed choices, and that's to the benefit of Scottish agriculture so that we can maintain good animal welfare and good animal health standards. So, we've produced infographics to help on what the different schemes mean, but we really need clearer labelling on non-stun slaughter. And so we really push for that because Scotland's already leading, but we're not getting credit and we've been disadvantaged as a market by not actually by not labelling meat in supermarkets as to whether it is unstunned.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to questions from Jenny.
Thank you, Convener. We've already heard Dr. Roman Pizzi's views on the Scottish Veterinary Service, but I wondered if any of the other panellists would like to make some comments on their thoughts about it and how it could change, improve veterinary services in Scotland. And Dr. Romain, perhaps you might want to add something else to the comments you've already made. Thank you. Well, we start with Mike.
Yeah, thank you very much for asking that question. It's something I've been in the society 34 years, and I remember what used to be the Ministry of Agriculture Vets. And over the years, systematically, funding has dropped and dropped and dropped. And if we're going to do this properly, and I'm fully supportive of it, it's got to be funded and manned properly. Now, you've already heard from Romain earlier about the shortage of vets, and that's over the whole spectrum. When you get into livestock veterinary medicine, that is a really diminishing number, and it's something that, to maintain our high animal welfare standards for livestock, something that's got to...
Sorry, Jim, we've lost you again. Kirsty, would you like to come in while we sort out Mike again, please?
I don't think I really need to add anything. I think Mike and Romain have made some good points and are better placed than I am to talk on this topic, so I won't take up any more.
And Simon, comments on the new veterinary service?
I can't really comment on the new veterinary service specifically. I would say that supporting Romain's points about the pressing need for more livestock vets, I think we also have a need for ongoing training of vets in some non-health aspects of animal welfare. And I would also agree with Mike's point that animal welfare, high animal welfare provision can indeed cost money. I would suggest also there are many cases where we can ensure win-wins here, where we can improve productivity, we can improve economic performance, and we can improve animal welfare simultaneously. And that can be delivered by a dialogue from vets to farmers. One case in point I can think of, for example, is that we have 4% of Scottish beef farmers currently use body condition scoring of their cattle in the recommended way. And the recommended way has been available, it's been known about since the 1960s. And yet it's very poorly adopted. There's little knowledge of how to do this very simple, zero cost procedure by farmers and also within the veterinary profession. So it's an example of where we can improve feed use, we can improve animal welfare, we can improve disease resistance within these animals by a little bit of training and dialogue of vets and of farmers. So I think that's all I would add to that point.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Rachel for a brief supplementary and then Jim.
Yes, it was just about the support that was offered by the UK government back in the early months of this year with regard to EVOs and OVs to help, obviously, with some export checks. I just wondered how you felt that had been of benefit at all to local authorities and if it's something that, you know, we should be looking at in terms of a long-term strategic intervention.
Anyone like to take that one on?
I think, I mean, I will probably have to send you something further in writing so that I don't get, you know, I give you some more factual information because, again, it's not my field of specialty. But I think the problem is I don't think this has been tested adequately at the moment because we've pushed things into the long grass with proper checks and the, you know, the international trade at the moment. So we haven't really tested to see how robust it is. So we've coped better with capacity in Scotland than they have in England, and that's great. But then our agriculture is quite different. So I've highlighted the problems we've got with agriculture, which is economically really important to Scotland and not similarly down in England. And so it maybe gets neglected by central government. But once, you know, everything is running as it supposedly should, it'll probably be too late to find out that, you know, that the system doesn't work. So I'm not sure that is a solution in itself. I mean, we have a benefit in Scotland in many bits are actually functioning better than in other parts of the UK. So the Food Standard Scotland, for example, has much better employment and retention levels than down in England. And so, you know, the Chief Veterinary Officer and everyone working in that field has been very good. So that the terms of employment for vets in there are beneficial, and it's actually been held out as a model to the rest of the UK to sort of follow. But we are very acutely aware, not just of veterinary capacity, but funding. So if there's a Scottish veterinary service, it is really essential. It may need additional funding to function at the level it is if we're going to sort of do it in separation. And we can see advantages to that, and I've highlighted some of the risks. The other thing I just wanted to mention very briefly is veterinary capacity in the UK. So VVA overall welcomes that the SRUC is looking at opening a new vet school. However, there's no point in doing that if there's not additional funding, because otherwise we're just diluting the funding between the existing vet schools and the new vet school, and we'll water everything down. We do need the additional funding to make sure that we don't dilute the current veterinary education, and also to try and better engage with the market. Because, you know, the market forces are very important in what is driving this.
A supplementary on that topic.
Yeah, it's very specifically to do with veterinary capacity. We know that you'll know yourself that the Scotch brand demands that you have a veterinary plan which is updated every year for whether it's a beef herd or a flock of sheep. What we're finding in the field is that more and more veterinary practices are focusing on small animals and going out of farm animals completely. So where, do you see a point where there is simply not the capacity within the veterinary service to be able to allow us to do what we're currently doing, let alone going further and where and in our ambition of where we want to go?
But this is a real problem that you've highlighted. So it's an excellent question. I mean, the BVA has been engaged with all the stakeholders trying to solve this, as we've seen this developing over several years. And obviously, the combination of Brexit and COVID has exacerbated everything. But we feel there isn't just one solution. So a new vet school can help, but it cannot solve everything in itself, because the way that the legislation is set up with the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons, once you're qualified as a vet, you can choose to do what you want. So SRUC's approach obviously is to try and increase the diversity and background of people coming in to the veterinary profession. And that's great, but it doesn't mean that they will stay there. So what we are trying to encourage from the British Veterinary Association is engagement with all the stakeholders to change some of the market forces, because many of the agricultural placements, but particularly the meat hygiene, for example, has relied on EU veterinarians to do this, where the market forces have meant that it's been appealing in terms of work and in terms of pay. But that source of veterinarians has gone now, and so it is not competitive with other draws from veterinary practice. So there's a shortage of vets everywhere, and even if we can obviously train vets better, we can select vets from a stronger background, we can, in the veterinary education, which we're quite keen on, is change the perception of food security, because there are many benefits and there are many appealing parts to doing this as a veterinarian, but they're not always conveyed at that veterinary training. But the problem is, if we don't also address the market forces, people will go into this and then they'll be pulled into pet animal medicine or anything else, because that's how the market forces will work at the moment. And there is a shortage of vets across the board, even in pet animal medicine, as you will have seen in the media. So I think it has to be very joined up, unfortunately, to find a solution. New vet school or any single solution in itself is not going to solve the problem that is developing and that we can see with horizon scanning.
Thank you. We're very conscious of the shortage of time. Can I now move on to questions from Ariane, please?
Or this is on farm animal welfare. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. So this would be to ask a question then. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on maximum journey times, particularly in the context of the Scottish Islands. So this is journey times of farmed animals. So we have, for example, 9 hours maximum for calves, up to 9 months, 12 hours for newly weaned pigs, 21 hours for sheep and cattle. So how can we set a maximum journey time limit that does not unduly distress the animals while allowing for longer distances they need to be covered between the mainland and the islands? And maybe we'll start with Mike.
Thank you for unmuting me. Yeah, I mean, it's obviously long distance transport's a concern of everybody in the sector, including the farmer. But if you look at the amount of abattoirs that have diminished over the years, a lot of these places used to be served by their own local abattoir. There is talk about mobile abattoirs coming in, but then they present problems themselves. But you've got to remember, places like Shetland and Orkney are very strong on their animal welfare and rearing animals, and they do play a very important part. But what we say is all scientific evidence should be followed at all times. There is a lot of research going on, and if that was followed, that would diminish a lot of the problems.
Can I come back at that as well also? Yeah, I would agree. I think we need some research on the design and the animal welfare impacts of mobile abattoirs. There would seem to be a value in them, but we need to get that right. I think the work on, there's a huge body of research on animal transport. It is very skewed towards the transport of fit animals for slaughter. There's been much less research on transport of young animals and also the transport of animals towards the end of their productive life, so things like Bentley hens, cull sows, and so on. And I think we need, in terms of objectively setting journey maximum journey lengths, thermal thresholds, and so on, we need that research to happen. With regard to the specific case of the Scottish Islands and Scotland more generally, I understand transport is not my specific area, but we do have colleagues who are very well versed in this. I understand that if there is a change in the view of transporting animals from the islands in cassettes, which is currently regarded as neutral time rather than part of the actual journey, then that would pose problems with regard to calves, and they would exceed the 9-hour transport limit. There are also issues if we regard layer hens as requiring the same maximum journey length of 4 hours as broilers, then that would pose problems with regard to moving those hens down to England where they're currently slaughtered. So I think there are specific practical issues, but there is also some basic research needed on defining some of these thresholds objectively for some classes and some ages of animals, which we haven't yet done.
Thank you. And could I hear from Kirsty?
Thank you. Yes, we appreciate the work that has been done by both the UK and improve the standards during transport. However, we feel that these maximum times are still too long. We should be aiming for the fewest and shortest journeys possible. I think that the potentials for small local and or mobile abattoirs should definitely be utilised more to help shorten journey times. With regards to the Scottish Islands, it is quite a unique situation that does pose challenges. I understand that. We would not be against there being exceptions made for transport to and from the islands, particularly because they have been designed with welfare in mind, and they are somewhat different from other forms of transport. However, that should be an interim measure. And longer term, we should be looking at shorter supply chains, shorter journeys, and local abattoirs, which actually, as I understand it, a lot of farmers want. It would benefit local communities as well as animal welfare, so it's kind of a win-win. I understand that in the very short term that's going to be difficult, but that's what we should be aiming towards, and we should be aiming towards moving away from sort of intensive systems, long journeys, back towards local farming and local supply chains.
Thank you.
Just to carry on in that, does anybody have any particular opinions on the legislative consent motion that has been lodged with the Scottish Parliament with regards to animal movements, and particularly the UK-wide ban on export of animals for live slaughter? Dr. Pizzi.
So I know at first glance it sometimes looks contentious. So the British Veterinary Association's, we know that the ban is coming in. We don't support it as it currently stands. And the reason behind this, when it always takes people aback, is that we think, unfortunately, it just puts all the welfare concerns onto journey length. And so the problem is the quality of the journey is possibly even more important for the animal. So obviously, British Veterinary Association always believes that the best is for animals to be slaughtered as close to the point of production as possible. But you can't simplify the journey into just length and time. And so there are other methods that are obviously important for improving the welfare during transport as a whole that we'd really like to see, taken forward more. So formal training for the transporters of live animals, we think that can be improved. Improved enforcement of the current regulations, because if they're not followed, it doesn't matter what they are. And then improving the guidance on when is an animal actually fit to travel, as Simon's already alluded to. So we share the concerns about how this may impact, remote and rural farms as well in the Highlands and the Islands. Now, from the BVA perspective, we recognise that mobile abattoirs do provide opportunities for slaughtering animals closer to point of production. So that's great, and we do want to investigate that further. However, it needs to be balanced that mobile abattoirs don't represent a downgrading of animal health and welfare, otherwise that's going to be counterproductive, and also public health standards. So we need to be assured that the mobile abattoirs can result in safe product to to the consumers. So we don't want to improve the, apparently improve the situation, but end up with a public health problem, and also that animal health and welfare can also be guarded by that. So, you know, we'd love to work together with government to make sure that this is viable and investigate this further.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Alistair.
Thank you very much, Convener. I appreciate the fact that Kirsty Jenkins was talking about Treething Islands slightly exceptionally. I represent some islands. And also I noticed you were talking about food miles and the need in the longer term to try and reduce some of that. Would you acknowledge, however, that in the islands, as in many other parts of Scotland, the whole lamb industry is built around the idea of livestock being moved around? And in the case of the prawn industry, if we move a bit further down the evolutionary scale, that is based on the idea of the live transport of prawns, because it's not possible to transport them any other way. And 90% or something in that region of the market for prawns exists in France and Spain. So would you appreciate, we do have to be slightly careful, notwithstanding everything that you've just said about the importance of reducing food miles and promoting local markets, and trying to pretend that we can undo those realities anytime soon.
Would you like to comment?
Yeah, I acknowledge that in the short term and even the medium term, there will need to be interim measures that might not be exactly as we would like it. However, in the longer term, I feel that our food systems are very broken and that we need to be aiming towards quite major changes in our food systems, and that includes our animal farming. One kind is member of the Scottish Food Coalition, and we obviously agree with their ethos, and they've outlined a vision for a food system that is quite different. So, of course, in the short term, interim measures may be quite different. And obviously, we do not want to penalise farmers or anybody else in the supply chains. And so there needs to be a just transition when we're talking about these things. But in the long term, we would like to see quite major changes, yes.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to questions on domestic animal welfare with Karen.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel today. I'd just like to touch upon a couple of things. I know we're running out of time, so I'll try and be as brief as I can. And I mean, it's probably going to be quite a big answer here, but having had large breed dogs and you know, a dog owner, I understand the responsibility that comes with pet ownership, and particularly the gravity of the duty of care that is involved. But I'm sure, for example, that my large breed, mostly sofa-dwelling dog has different needs and requirements to those who go out and earn their treats for a living, should we say. So to ask, and you know, in light of the review around animal welfare legislation, what would you like to see covered? But also within that, do you make that distinction between domesticated companion pets and working dogs?
Maybe kick off with Mike.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a very good question. You've all seen the recent consultation, which was more about the Dangerous Dogs Act, but the implementation of it, not the actual act itself. We've always disagreed with Section 1 of that act, just because it mentions four breeds and they're automatically dangerous, which just gives the public a false sense of security. They're not the most dangerous dogs. There's mastiffs coming in from everywhere now. It's all about responsible ownership, people choosing the right dog that fits their lifestyle and their needs and their capabilities. Behind every dangerous dog is basically a dangerous owner, an irresponsible owner. So we would like to see the Dangerous Dogs Act changed to repeal Section 1 and recognise it's the deed of the Animals Act, not the breed. I think that would go some way to help local authorities and everyone with their control notices and everything like that. Thank you.
Kirsty?
Thanks. Yeah, just to say first that I very much agree with what Mike just said. On the question more widely, I think that's a good question and it's important to think about, but I I would probably try and avoid sort of categorising animals too much and, you know, slotting them into boxes, and just look at the individual animal in any given circumstances and what the welfare risks and potentials are there. I'm not sure if that quite answers your question. I'm happy to talk more on that, but I think, you know, a dog is a dog, and in any given scenario, I would look at what the welfare was in that moment rather than sort of categorising.
Dr. Pizzi?
I think we're in alignment. I mean, we completely agree with the Scottish SPCA that, you know, the dangerous dogs, it is the deed, not the breed. And so it's the situation you place dogs into will be the determinants. And I think also aligning pretty much with Kirsty is that the basic welfare requirements of dogs in general need to be met. And then the additional welfare considerations depend on individual dog situation. So I don't think we can really categorize it because there are lots of gray areas. So it's going to be a continuum. So I think that's unfortunately possibly unworkable, but completely agree with Mike's comments on the move away from breeds being a problem to the people involved and how those dogs are handled, and it being a deed based thing. And there's been, you know, we've collaborated with the campaigns on that.
If I could just also support Kirsty's comment that I think it's dangerous, whether we're talking about dogs or indeed any type of animal, to silo them into categories. When we look at the various animals we manage, we find that their motivations have been preserved across the process of domestication, and that the motivations from one dog is probably very similar to the motivations for another. So, for example, a brachycephalic breed that struggles to exercise may well still have a motivation to exercise, even if physically struggle to do so. So I think we need to be cognizant of that and not silo them in a way that is convenient for us.
Yeah, just coming in there, you know, I understand what you're saying then in regards to, you know, not labelling particular breeds and, you know, the onus is on the handler, but also, you know, the situations that the dogs will be in, particularly if they're going to be working dogs, aren't necessarily going to be the same situation as domesticated stay-at-home companion pets. So my concern would be there in regards to any, you know, future reviews, if, you know, to take that into consideration there for the protection and the welfare, obviously, of those working animals. And just on the back of that quickly, you know, there has been problems arising in regards to the pandemic around animal welfare. And I was just wondering if you could touch upon a couple of those issues there. Thank you.
Yeah, kick off the mic again.
If I'm unmuted, can I kick off there? Just your first point about working in domestic pets, so to speak. The basic law is the same. You've still got to provide the same level of care, nutrition, shelter and all that kind of stuff. So that's not the major issue, whether it's a sheepdog or a guard dog or a police dog or anything like that. The pandemic has caused serious issues with the domestic animal front. The puppy sales have just gone through the roof, which has led to very poor welfare animals being brought in, mainly to Scotland via from South Ireland via Northern Ireland, but we're seeing a rise in the amount of dogs coming in from alleged kill shelters in Romania. Now, that presents another health problem, animal health problem, which remains touched about earlier on the fact of proper lack of properly veterinary inspection at point of entry and all that kind of stuff. So the pandemic has been an absolute nightmare in the domestic pet trade since it came in, since COVID started. And people are making an absolute fortune in doing it and basically spreading misery. Thank you.
Kirsty, very briefly.
Yes, I mean, I think Mike's outlined that point quite well. Just to speak to the wider question again, I think something that's worth thinking about on both of the points sort of touched on in the question there is that what would be really helpful is just better knowledge and education of dogs. I think there's been a huge problem in general that's been intensified by the pandemic of lack of proper socialisation and training for dogs in general, and understanding of dogs' behaviour and body language. And again, this touches on the Dangerous Dogs Act, the pandemic and so on. Across all of these, what we're seeing is a lot of these problems are made worse by the fact that people don't necessarily know how to provide for the dogs, especially in terms of their sort of behavioural needs. So that's something I know that, for example, the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission is looking at dog training and professional dog trainers and so on, and how they could potentially be regulated. And I think possibly that's the kind of thing that might be a solution, rather than trying to, through legislation, slot different dogs into different boxes, is to try and just have an overall better understanding of dogs and their needs and training.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Beatrice.
On the same line of question about domestic dogs, and I mean, I take on board the comments about responsible ownership and education. I mean, I know that's something crofters and farmers in my constituency would welcome, given the impact irresponsible dog ownership can have on livestock worrying, which is a scourge, particularly in the lambing season, and something that some dog owners just simply don't seem to understand. So I'd like the panel's views, and I could start with Mike, just on his thoughts on dogs and livestock worrying.
Thank you very much for the question. It's something that we worked very closely with Emma Harper when she was bringing the new legislation at the end of the last Parliament, and it's something, it's a huge welfare problem, and again, it comes back to irresponsible ownership. And it touches on some of the work that Kirsty referred to that the Commission's doing about animal training. It's all about positivity. It shouldn't be about putting an electric collar on it. If your dog's on a lead, it cannot attack a sheep. Now, one thing beyond that, people are getting issued with notices about the new legislation, or dog control notices. There is no central record for any of this. So I could get a dog control notice or a livestock notice said, served against me. The only person that would know about it is the constable or the local authority that served it. Another constable or local authority does not necessarily know that. And you get people breaking bans, court bans, that they're banned from keeping a dog, but they go and get one, and there's just no way of monitoring that. So that would be one way of joining together all the kind of enforcement that's going on if there was a national register. Thank you.
I think Dr. Pizzi wants to come in.
Oh, sorry, it was for previous. I think we're supportive of the SSPCA's position in that, you know, we call for a complete ban on the sale and use of electric shock collars, and the evidence does show that reward-based training is the most effective training method for dogs and cats. And it also makes sure that obviously the animals are protected from any pain or suffering. And I think it comes back to, it's not the breed or usually the individual animal, but it's the situation and the people involved that we need to focus on, as Mike you know, has alluded to. So we know that there's been a review by the Scottish Government of the guidance on aversive training advices, and we'd be keen, you know, obviously to see that and feedback. We know that there were some fears on a judicial review if they were to, you know, if the devices were to be banned. But when, you know, DEFRA announced a ban and there was a judicial review, then it was found in DEFRA's favour. So we don't see it. I think there is a serious problem, but I don't think that aversive training devices, shock collars, are a reasonable way of mitigating that. We have to find other ways to do it.
Thank you. Just conscious of time, we've got 5 minutes max left. Rachel, can I ask your final question in this section, and I'll move to Ariane.
Thanks, Kavina. The SSPCA highlighted a link between domestic abuse and animal cruelty, particularly during the pandemic. And I wondered if the panel agreed if this committee, as part of a wider animal welfare issue, should be looking at raising awareness amongst veterinarians and other people who work in the industry to establish that link and to use that as a way to kind of stamp out this domestic abuse that is happening, because there is that intrinsic link. Can I go to Mike, please?
Yes, certainly. There is an organisation called the Links Group, which is aimed at linking veterinary profession, medical staff, police, social workers, animal welfare workers and stuff. And there is a proven link. It's not a theory that's going about. A human that harms an animal is five times more likely to harm a human being. So it is there. In certain parts of certain professions, police, social worker and animal welfare are taking it very, very seriously, but it's just not getting the push that it deserves. And that is back to my previous answer. If there was a national register of these offenders, then that could alert social working police officers throughout the UK of a potential threat. And it's a potential threat. Not everyone that's cruel to an animal is cruel to a human, but the instances of it are far higher. So it's something we would definitely do, and the education of all sectors. I mean, I think the government many years ago, the Scottish Government, invested money in training dentists to spot signs of domestic abuse. I mean, that's a kind of out-of-the-bit thing. Hairdressers were also trained about that, because a lady can be sitting there, it's a one-to-one, it's given them an opening to actually open up and say what's happening. And it is surprising the amount of times we're contacted by the police investigating a domestic violence thing, and they have found out or heard that we had investigated an animal cruelty aspect maybe a year or two before. But it's a very, very important topic, and it's something the Scottish SPCA and the BVA are doing everything they can possibly do to promote to the other professions. Thank you.
If any of the other witnesses would like to respond to that question, maybe you could do it in writing, and that will probably apply to the question that Ariane's going to ask. We're very short of time. So if you'd like to respond to some of the questions, but you don't get the opportunity, if you could write to the committee, that would be very much appreciated. Ariane.
So this is moving on to the theme of wildlife animal welfare. I'm going to keep my question very brief. I'm just curious to hear from the panel whether there are any gaps in the Scottish Government's agenda in relationship to welfare of wildlife. And I think we'll just start with Kirsty, and then if we've got time, Mike.
Yes, thank you. I could say a lot on this, but I will keep it brief if we're short on time. There are lots of changes coming up soon in terms of various aspects of wild animal management. I think what we would really like to see at this stage is more of an umbrella framework that guides decision making in wild animal management that's based on evidence and ethics. I think at the moment, quite often, the different topics, the different methods, the different species are placed in silos to some extent. So that's the big change we'd like to see, probably. Just very briefly, while we're on wild animals, an immediate concern is the upcoming review of snaring that the Scottish Government is required to carry out by the end of this year. The previous snaring review in 2016 was very limited in scope. It did not lead to real change. We believe that snares should be banned due to the immense suffering that they cause. And it's really important that this year's review fully considers that.
Yeah, thank you very much. I agree with everything Kirsty just said there. There are plans in motion for the government, whether it be the fox hunting, and whether it totally finally ban it properly, or at least reduce the hunt pack down to a maximum of two dogs, as is in England and Wales. There is a lot of research going on wild animal welfare going on. The biggest problem that we perceive, and it's no disrespect to anybody, is the lack of enforcement when it comes to general wildlife crime. So we welcomed the Minister's statement in the last session, setting up a task force to just see how that can be addressed, whether we can be of any more assistance. And I think that would go a long way to tackle the known crimes. But then it's back to what Kirsty was saying, is about culling of mountain hares or brown hares and all that kind of stuff. So it's something that's very much on our radar, but we would like to see the improvements that have already been talked about, and then possibly some more. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Just one general question to finish, but I would prefer if you were able to write to the committee with your responses. The provisions in the UK Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill, which apply in Scotland on the controlling of imports of domestic animals and provisions to modernise zoo licensing, there are specific implications in Scotland. Could you feed back your views on how these implications might cause issues here, and comment on any engagement you've had or consultations you've had with regards to that bill? And that would be That would be most helpful. Thank you very much for your contributions today, and I very much appreciate your patience, given that the IT problems. We'll no doubt come back to you at some point later in the session to explore some of the issues raised today more fully. But thank you very much for your contributions. I now bring this part of the meeting to an end, and we now go into private session.